So Patrick Long, if you could describe this lunch in one word, what would it be?
Randomness.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right, cool.
And now for Dinner with Racers, presented by
Continental Tire,
with your hosts, Ryan Eversley and Sean Heckman.
Placeholder radio sound. I'm a driver. I'm very angry. The sound of a driver on the radio during a race.
What do you think I should call it?
Welcome to Dinner with Racers. I am Sean Heckman.
And I am Ryan Eversley.
So if you don't know us, good on you.
Or Google it.
Anyway, we are coming to you live from somewhere between Florida and Atlanta. We are wrapping up a 30-day trip around the country. And we've driven how many miles?
8,000 miles.
Across 20 states. Yeah. And
we used my Acura MDX. And we did the whole thing on Continental Tires.
Just deliver 27 meals to your home in the form of a podcast.
You better say thank you.
So for this next one, we headed out to Venice, California. Yeah, California now.
Venice Beach in Miami.
To meet a local boy out there, young Patrick Long, who is a American Porsche factory driver.
He's a kid on his way up, right?
Yeah, in his 30s.
Yeah.
He is currently the lone American Porsche factory driver out there. So Porsche basically employs him, pays a salary, tells him where to go, and he goes. And that's kind of his job. Here's the thing about Patrick. Being a Porsche factory driver, he's kind of cut and dry in the way he presents himself.
He's very German.
Known as sort of being a very professional in his presentation. That's all there is. But the Patrick that we know and love is actually very funny, very cool when he can be.
Dry sense of humor. Ginger. Did we mention that already?
I don't know, but we can't mention that enough.
Okay. Currently teamed up with the very, very well-known Marco Seyfried.
Exactly.
And the WEC.
Yep. Marco Seyfried and Patrick Long took their first win.
That's right.
A couple weeks ago. And anyway, so that's that. So anyway, Patrick Long, very accomplished. He's one of the few Americans that's kind of won every major endurance race out there. He's won Le Mans. He's won Daytona, Sebring, Petit Le Mans.
Yep.
Even the Baja 1000.
That's right. That's right.
So, even took a stab when he could at NASCAR. Even ran a Sprint Cup race at Watkins Glen. Ran an Xfinity Series at Road America. And almost won a K&N race, beating Joey Logano in the last corner.
And he talks about that in the podcast.
Exactly.
If you look him up on Wikipedia, it's funny, for as traditional sports car racing history as he has, it's all NASCAR stats. So, yeah, come listen to Patrick Long talk about both sides of his career.
So we headed out to Deus Ex Machina in Venice. Awesome place.
Probably the coolest stop, I think, for me, because I'm a total gearhead with motorcycles. I have a couple myself, and this was just like kid in a candy store for me.
Exactly. What did you have?
I had the granola yogurt and a latte.
And I had a chicken sandwich. And let's hear some Patrick Long. Thanks once again to Continental Tire.
Meow.
All right, we're going to start in 5, 4, 3, 2.
Oh, look, Patrick is here.
Oh, wow, and he brought you
with
food.
With my bacon avocado sandwich. I mean, chicken sandwich. So, no, we were, yeah. There you go. You're getting close. There he is. Careful of your sunglasses on the top of your head, LA asshole.
Radio check.
There we go.
Can you actually hear?
Can you hear us again?
Yeah.
No, I was just saying, so your email to me is like, yeah, you been to Deus? I'm like, oh, I don't want to look like I don't know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I haven't been yet. But, yeah, no, let's go there. And then I look it up, and all I'm reading about is Deus, this, like, motorcycle garage.
Yeah.
Like, oh, shit, that's not the place. And then I do a little bit more searching. It's like, oh, they've got a cafe attached. I'm like, I bet that's it. But I don't want to have like two different deuses that I don't know about. So I have to fess up. I'm like, okay, is it this? And you're like, yeah, of course it is. Dipshit.
Everybody knows that.
So
it's pretty low key, as you.
It is.
You've come to find out.
It's everything I hoped it would be.
Good.
Now, is it a problem that we're not in flannel?
Definitely. Yep. And, you know, you should have a V-neck on as well.
Yeah, I don't have a V-neck. I'm wearing Pumas.
Definitely an East Coast transplant.
How did you find this place?
I was racing V8 supercars, and we were cruising in Melbourne, and I don't remember what the street was called, but it was just a fashionista street, and we walked into this pop-up store, and there was this brand, and I looked at my wife, and I was like, this is what I've been looking for my whole life. And they're an Australian-based brand that's around surfing and bicycles and motorcycles,
right.
And just, yeah, what you see is what you get. But I knew this location. It used to be a florist on Lincoln and Venice on the corner, and it's a pretty famous old building. And one day I saw on the typical prop-up, you know, gas station letters that it said, coming soon, Los Angeles Dais. And I thought, it's got to be a different dais. You know, it's in the standard black letters. And sure enough, like 3 months later, they pulled the boards off the wall. And here we have this, you know, retro motorcycle coffee bar right in the thick of West LA.
Right.
And everybody just threw their hands up like, where was this for the last 15 years? And the brand itself was pretty new to America, and it exploded pretty quick. And now it's as much an experience coming here as it is, you know, a clothing company or a motorcycle builder. They build custom bikes. I mean, it's a 1 year waiting list and a lot of coin, and it's kind of the bike of the celebrities. It's
kind of
think Singer of motorcycles, but past that, they've kind of just honed in on just being more of a lifestyle brand. And
right.
With
and
that,
the bikes are like retro style cafe racer types,
bobbers, track racers.
Yeah, and that is kind of evolved. The cafe racer sort of UK scene has kind of evolved more into like street trackers. You know, you see the scrambler that Ducati just put out. It's going a little more roughneck, sort of
brat style,
dirt/slash street, which I love. You know, vintage flat track was something that I grew up on. I mean, on any Sunday was my Bible. And so to see that, like, street trackers are finally making it to mainstream is kind of cool.
It's funny that you mentioned on any Sunday, and that's literally the shirt that Ryan's wearing right
now.
You're
so
you're proud of yourself.
Damn. Like, yeah. Well, I would have never said that if I knew you were wearing that T-shirt.
Yeah, when we were
you just gave him validity.
I mean, I didn't know we were coming here. This is a shirt I just got because I love the shirt. And it's a Bruce Brown film. And if you've ever seen
Dust to Glory.
Yeah. That's Dana Brown. That's his son.
Yeah.
And so once I saw that, that's what actually introduced me to the old, you know, Endless Summer videos and everything. Just trying to check the history on Bruce Brown. And when you said we were coming here, I was like, oh yes. I mean, I don't have any skinny jeans because I don't own any skinny jeans.
Yeah.
But I was like, okay, I have a shirt that won't make me look completely moronic.
If you did have skinny jeans, this would be the.
This we are wearing.
Yeah, I'm in a polo and like borderline JAD jeans. I don't fit in.
Actually,
anywhere.
Hipsters these days, especially in Venice, are going as far away from the iconic hipster gear as ever.
We were just talking about that.
Out hipster hipsters.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
You've got to go the opposite direction because now it's all available at Nordstrom. So
the shirt that I came up with like a year and a half ago when I was making fun of Pompelli one day because he wants to be a hipster was once everyone's a hipster, no one is.
That's right.
Yep.
So that's the shirt I want. You know, if everyone's hipster, no one is.
That's right.
There you go. All right. You awake, by the way?
I'm awake. I've been awake since 3 a.m. I'm on Japan time. So fatherhood is unexpected. I mean, everybody tells you it's the greatest thing and wait for this and when you meet eyes and all that like cliche stuff. But it doesn't prepare you. You can't explain it. So it's awesome.
Nice.
Now, I'm going to bring this up because it's staring me right in the face. Is that mustache? Has that been around a while?
It's technically a teen stash.
Okay, because I'm pretty pissed off I shave now.
Yeah.
Because I grew out a pretty badass mustache. Well,
oh,
I had
nice.
The beard going, but this morning I was shaving. I was like, we're going to Venice. I think I'm supposed to have some sort of weird, creepy mustache.
Yeah, if I'm going to partake in Movember, I got to start in September.
Fair enough.
So Ryan and I were talking on the way in, and I don't want to hijack your question, Ryan, but we were wondering which Patrick Long we were going to get today.
And the choices were Porsche Robot, Patrick Long, or Mexican Wedding, Patrick Long.
Yeah, you're going to get something in between. You're going to get, like, off-the-clock Patrick Long.
Perfect.
So, like, I'm not party time and I'm not work time. I'm just kind of, like, getting back onto mellow life time.
Is this life in between races right now? You're just sort of showing up at coffee shops and
pretty much
meetings?
Yeah, I mean, right now we're on a 7-week string, which for the motorsport world isn't much. But for me, after being off the road in the summer because WEC takes it off, I'm definitely back into the swing of things where you can't walk into my office because it's just dirty race suits and invoices that are way past due. but I'll be home for 3 days and then I leave this weekend to go do our young driver assessment in Alabama, come back 2 days later, and then a handful of days later go back over to China. So just kind of few days off and back on the road, which is probably 99% of the people that you're talking to right now.
Everybody's enjoying
no big
it.
Deal. Yeah.
Are you the only Porsche factory guy at the driver assessment deal?
Yeah.
And that's kind of your deal though, isn't it?
Yeah, we started it on a kind of a whim. It was a last minute deal where Jens Valter, the president of North America, Porsche Motorsport North America, and I were talking about, you know, all the young drivers that are starting to key into one make cup racing in North America, where it had traditionally been more of a journeyman series.
Yeah.
And I said to him, you know, the reason that all of us are where we are is because of a young driver assessment that they did in Germany. They now do a Super Cup one where they take all of the different career cups from around the world and bring one together.
Yeah.
And I said, let's try and put something together for North America. And it was all green lights, but we were all busy doing our own thing. And about a month before, he called me and he's like, I have no time to put this together. Let's go to, that must have been 2012, let's go to 13 with this concept, and I still like it. It was modified based on what we did in Germany and what I went through myself in 2002. And I said, no, give this to me and let
you make it yours.
Fall on my face, but let me try to make this happen.
Yeah.
And I had the time that I don't know what I was doing that year racing wise, but I had a couple weeks off, and we threw it together, and we've been every year since. And you know, some guys have come through: Spencer Pigot, Michael Lewis, you know, this year's champion from the series in America, Elliot Skier. We've had some great kids come through, and it's more of a assessment / workshop. We don't really, you know, scream and throw whistles in the air and award you something. It's more like, hey, we want to give you a couple days in a car and take a look at you and give you a takeaway, not just break you down and silently judge you, but give you a bunch of takeaways. So it's a, you know, standard stuff like media and you know, the first day is all out of the car.
Yeah.
And it's probably a more rigorous day than the second day, which is in car. The selection process is down to Porsche North America and what they decide. It's not a write in and hope to be on American Idol. So it's evolving always. But four drivers, a couple days at the track.
What's the hope for those guys when they come out of it?
The hope for them is always different. We've graduated probably one out of four each year has found their way to the series. And a couple of them have made even a couple more steps past. Michael Lewis, you know, was full-time in World Challenge this year. And that all evolved out of a kid who was out of a ride coming out of Formula Cars in Europe and didn't even know what sports car series existed in the U.S. So it's basically to get them on the radar of not only Porsche, but some of the media and other, you know, key members of the Porsche group. And for them to go away realizing where they're at and if GT racing or Porsche racing is what they thought it was going to be.
So for the media training, it's like which color hue to use on Instagram pictures and how to fit sentences into 140 characters.
It's basically how to clean and press a white, crispy button-up shirt. And no, it's fun. I mean, we've had Justin Bell out. We've had this year we're going to have Bob Varsha, and it's very interactive. It's not so much about just a 45-minute speech and then you go away. So, we try to mix it up.
So set the stage for us. We kind of talked about it a little bit earlier, but where are we right now? And you don't have shoes on. Kind of explain to me. I just looked down. I'm like, oh, those are toes.
Sorry.
No, it's all good. Hey, this is your chill period.
This is your deal,
so,
man.
Like, I know I am. I barely wear pants. So where are we right now? We're on the roof at the place that you hang out, but this is like the area you've grew up in, or you moved here?
I grew up in LA, about an hour north of here.
Okay.
Kind of suburbia between the beach, the valley, and the city. And I now live two villages south of here on the coast, Manhattan Beach, which is just south of LAX. Venice is your typical free-spirited, get crazy, artistic. But it's now had a huge movement of Google and a lot of tech movement. And so it's very progressive, very high end, but pretty free spirited. And so I find myself, a lot of my friends away from the racing scene live here. So we spend a lot of time here, but don't necessarily want to live here because it's a little more wild than maybe you want full time. But Manhattan Beach is pretty mellow. But I hang out here a lot, especially days. It's just like I said, it's just a spot to have a 45-minute conversation with someone who's from in town or out of town. It's pretty central, and traffic's not too bad. You don't have to access any freeways.
Unless you're coming from Pasadena.
Yeah, unless you live in BF nowhere.
So the Young Drivers Test actually brings up one, you know, we don't want to make this a bunch of Porsche questions,
yeah, really,
but it does bring one sort of central question, which is, in my observation, you and I actually haven't talked about this, but in my observation, you're doing things to set yourself up for life outside of the car.
Yes and no.
Okay.
I think there's a consistent food chain in everything, business, life, etc. I enjoy working with some young drivers. I think that I had great mentors when I was 21 and wondering if I was going to make it, and I figured this would be a way to be a bit proactive, not only in learning the ropes and understanding where I might fit in the motorsport world after driving, but selfishly, I figured if I'm going to have to pass the torch, let me have a hand in it.
Sure.
And not just have someone thrown to me and then I got to give them my playbook.
Right.
So it was kind of a way to give back but also serve myself, if that's completely forthcoming. And then the other side of it is that learning what you do well and what you don't do well outside of the race car, because it always seems easy, but it's not. And I'm not a spreadsheet guy. I'm not an analyst, but I like the strategy side. I like the interaction side. I like, getting events
right
from beginning to end. So that type of stuff. I've kind of found a little bit of a way there. I don't consider myself a great driving coach per se, but I'm good at preaching to kids who are looking for some direction and are very fragmented in which way to go or what dad says versus manager versus whoever.
Right.
Exactly.
Without naming any names, are any of them just horrible? And I don't mean on track, like just attitude.
Yeah.
And right away, you know, like, oh, you never, you know.
I mean, I won't slam the gavel down like that, because if I sat with myself as a 19-year-old, I'd be like, Jesus, that was a painful experience. So I kind of try to look through that and see what the end result could be. But so far, you know, I was talking to Calvin Fish, who does some work with young drivers, and I told him that so far the 30-minute lunch meeting hasn't let me down, in the sense of if you really get a good feeling in that first 30 minutes in how the kid approaches life or the conversation or how he eats his food, there's some transition or connection to how they operate on track and around the track. And that's worked for me. I guess the second part of that is, if you can't get through 30 minutes of lunch, then you don't really want to be in regular contact or work with them down the road.
Yeah.
I get the question all the time, because I've clearly made it. That's why I'm sitting on a roof with you in Venice. How do you make it as a race car driver? And I always, you know, Lally kind of said, don't be bitter. That's his thing.
That's his big thing.
And I just say, be likable, because a lot of our business, as you know, is driving with guys that aren't doing this for a living. They're doing it for fun, and this is vacation. And if you're a snot-nosed pain in the ass, they're not going to want to go to dinner with you. They're not going to want their wife to go to dinner with you, and then you're out. So like you say, if you can't get through a 30-minute lunch with somebody, you're probably not long for the world.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. That's great. That's a great way to sum it up. I honestly can't answer that question if someone is willing to ask it to me. But I do say that today's young aspiring racing driver has a harder road than what you or I was, or you, Sean, were faced with, is because social media literally makes you think you're someone you're not. And you know, we had our supporters, our sponsors, our friends, our family who were pumping us up and trying to keep us confident so we could win a race or whatever. And that certainly creates a little bit of a complex. But, man, when the whole world is jocking you, I think that makes it really difficult for a youngster. And I think if social media was around when I was right on that cusp, I probably would have blown it. Yeah.
So I'm glad you kind of brought that up, because you and I met a long time ago. How old are you now?
I'm 34.
Okay, so I'm 31. You're a couple years older. You were racing for Peterson White Lightning. This is years ago. I mean, this is like 90.
See, I don't know how this is going to end.
It's
right
okay.
Here.
It actually ends really well, because
I'm with you here.
Yeah, he doesn't
I'm on
know
the same
I'm
train. Yeah, I'm on the same
so
roller coaster.
So Gunnar Jeanette introduced us at Road Atlanta Petite like 20 years ago. You were 14 years old. No, but a long time ago. And you snubbed me. It was
I was going to say, it could go either way here.
Very quick, like, oh, yeah, what's up? And I was like, I want to be you, and you're already racing ALMS, and I'm not racing anything. And I was like, no, like, American guy. And you gave me the kind of just like, yeah. And then, you know, I got to meet you throughout the years, and now I know that you're not like that. And then we went to Mexico for a wedding this year, and Sean wasn't invited. And
yep, it's true. Not welcome.
And you
Who's
and I
wedding?
Are, like, starting a guy named there's Elsa and
okay. Yeah. All right, that's out there.
So you and I go
it
to
awesome.
And Elsa Oliveira's wedding, and you're right next to me on the dance floor, like starting trouble and, you know, getting carried away with the night. And I was like, oh man, okay, Pat's, you know, he's a regular guy. Do you think it's because of the success you've had in your career, getting older, you've got a kid now, you're married, like you kind of know where you are in the world and now you can relax and you don't have to have sort of a front? Or do you think it was just being a 19-year-old kid who was on top of the world already?
You know, those years were like my first couple of years back from 7 years abroad, where, you know, this sounds like a sob story excuse, but, you know, over there, you're the black sheep, you're the one American, and your elbows are up, and the European national racing scene is not to make friends with your competition or the paddock. It's come, do your job, and, you know, if someone sees you in their mirror, hopefully they fear you. So I think a little bit of it was just coming off of that 7 years of just being a dick and just trying to win races. There's never really been a part of me that's thought, oh, I'm a Porsche factory driver and, you know, who's this toolbox? You know, it's more just, I think it was my guard or some way of being almost, you know, shy, which is easily attributed to being arrogant. But the other side of it is I've learned a ton in, you know, the years I've been around a lot of elder drivers that have broke it down for me quickly. And those are the ones, you know, they humble you quick. They call you on your crap quick. And I think it's just a combination of maturing. I think I was, as a 22-year-old kid, yeah, had a lot of growing up to do still. Yeah, not going to get all sobby on you now, but good thing you gave me a second chance. 40 tequilas in.
I brought you back.
We have yet to get tears on this podcast, so I think you should be our first.
Right. This should not be the first one to post. Right.
Do you have any dead puppies or anything?
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going.
I'm a dog guy, so now you're now you're really pulling.
Well,
there.
So is he. That's why.
So what kind of dog?
I have a golden retriever. He's a mix, so he's like a golden retriever on steroids or some other illegal substance. No, he's just out of control.
Interesting.
He's on fast forward, so he's like 3/4 the size of a normal golden retriever with twice the energy.
Nice.
But I grew up with Australian Shepherd, so dogs are
so
that's awesome.
A big part of your family. Well, and a golden retriever where you live, that's a beach kind of dog.
Yeah, it's pretty waspy. It's pretty turnkey. Like, the family in Manhattan Beach got a golden retriever. This dog's a nut, so he rubs that right away.
Nice. That's our first waspy on the air.
That is.
I like that.
Yeah.
I
hope to give you many firsts today. That's my goal.
You know, I don't want to go over the resume stuff, but your young idiot European exploits. I don't know that that's really out there. So we try and avoid the chronology stuff, but, you know, basically you were part of the California karting scene, which is, to me, insane how many of us came out of that. You know, just listen off some California guys. You, Joey, Mimo, Scott Speed. I mean, it's crazy to me how many. AJ Allmendinger. But you went a very different route because at a certain point you were off to Europe in Formula Renault. Correct?
Yeah, I started going over in the summers for karting, and as a lot of us did, just getting your butt handed to you because it's a whole different scene, different tires, different everything. And one of the race teams, CRG, that I was driving for their importer here, the Don, the big boss, pulled my dad aside in his broken Italian and said, "We think your kid is maybe got it, but, you know, he needs to, spare you the bad accent, he needs to live over here and eat, breathe, sleep, live racing if he wants a shot. He can't just show up for summer vacation and think he's going to make it even to the final."
Yeah.
So that was the beginning of it. So at 16, I packed up and left my friends and family behind as a junior and just stayed over a junior in high school and just sort of stayed in Europe full time. My first roommate was Ryan Briscoe. We lived above the workshop at CRG in a small town in Italy. And
what was that guy like?
Awesome. I mean, he probably... People were like, how could you go to Italy where no one speaks English at 16? And my standard answer is, well, you're too young and dumb to know and you just want to race. But
you just go.
It was probably partly having a cool Australian and Japanese roommate who kind of eased the pain of being in a small town, you know, or wasn't sitting in a basement alone by any stretch. I mean, we were too young to get awesome on the weekends, even though at 16 you could pretty much do anything in Italy. But we still had a good time and managed to hop up our 50cc scooters and, you know, tick some people off. So, yeah.
Nice. So you did years in Formula Renault. What were some of the guys you ran against?
Danny Watts was the champion in the year I did Formula Renault, which was 2002 when I was about out of money. I tried to make a jump to Formula 3 and didn't have the dosh, as they say. But, Jamie Green was my other teammate, Lewis Hamilton. I think that guy. Was that his name, Lewis Hamilton? Yeah, he was.
He's still an open wheel.
I actually started with Manor Motorsport, who is in Formula 1 right now, and that was the team to be at. And then there was this rookie kid, Lewis Hamilton, who we had all heard of because of go-karting, and it was his first year in cars, but...
At this point, he's already McLaren.
Yeah, he's already full McLaren. So there's three white cars and one silver car.
Did he have the blonde hair yet?
No.
Pre-blonde hair?
Yeah, no, okay. He's still minus the, yeah, no, it, he's, I still run into him, and he's a great guy. I give him credit for doing his own thing as a Formula
Absolutely.
One driver.
Yeah.
But, raw talent at 17 or whatever he was then. We're both sharing hotel rooms because neither one of us had the money to have our own Campanile or, Holiday Inn Express room. But fast, really fast, raw. And I think the second year, once I had, after I was gone, he cleaned up and, went on to his ways. But, yeah, Formula Renault, Formula Ford over there was stacked. I mean, it's a name-dropping session in itself to think about the guys that I lined up next to. I mean, as a junior in go-karting, I've got pictures sitting next to Fernando Alonso on, position or row four. Like, both of us are just trying to get to the front. So it was a good chunk of years in there where, England was kind of the melting pot. It's kind of diluted a little bit now into Euro series and French series and, even the Asian series. But back then, you pretty much had to be in the UK, as you know. So, it was a great time of learning a lot on the track and learning how to be close-shouldered and don't say hello to anybody, but also party time on the weekends.
Right. So who was it that you got into at the Formula Ford Festival?
He's a Swedish factory driver for Volvo, Robert Dahlgren. He was a third-year veteran in Formula Ford, and we went into the last round of the championship. This is 2001, and it was one of those classic things where he's 1 point ahead, he's one position behind me. He takes me out in the second-to-last corner, and he wins a championship, and it all went down like one of those storybooks. And so me being me, I go to the pub and tell everybody that he's got one more race in Formula Ford, and so do I, and he's going to have it back harder and meaner than what he gave it to me. The thing was is that we had three restarts in the pre-final at the Formula Ford Festival, which is the world championships of Formula Ford. It's the one race everybody wants to win. And they do it on aggregate when they have red flags because it was raining and it was a typical day at Brands Indy. So I had the thing locked up because I had been leading by a good stretch in the first two. But on the last restart, all I had to do was finish second behind him, and I would have started on pole, and I had the factory car, and it would have been see ya, because in the wet, our car was just money. And he started backing me up into Druids and just kind of effing with me, trying to get people behind me to get up and mix it up with me, maybe get me taken out. And so I just put my nose on his gearbox and turned left. I'd seen the move earlier in the week, and I was like, that is genius. And so it just sent him in a 90-degree corner, right into the barrier. Total asinine, dangerous move. But to me, I thought I just pulled it off with
well, at that
mastery.
Age, you're like, this
yeah,
is the
and
thing
so
you have
I'm
to
up
win.
On the podium, yeah. Like, he had it coming. That's what you get, and over the PA system, like, hello. So drive up to the grid, my hair's all moosed up, and I'm ready to win the Formula Ford Festival, and the grid guy's like, nope, I don't even see you on the paperwork. You're not your car number. You must not have made the final. And I'm looking at him like, dude, don't you know who I am?
Right.
And they're like, sorry, you're gone. Go pack your shit. You're out.
And that was, so you got kicked out of the Formula
right
Ford
there,
Festival.
Never took the start of the final. So that's another
so it's
yeah,
one
learning
on
experience.
The
right. Yeah. Another yeah. learning
because
experience.
Because you're like, what, 20-something, 22?
20 years old, yeah.
He's
yeah.
like, this is 6 weeks ago.
Yeah. Yeah, this was last weekend.
So did you ever catch up with that guy again and
oh,
sort
yeah.
it out?
Yeah, it was funny. I actually saw him at Daytona, 2007. He was walking the paddock. And
did you just mother...
I figured he was still mad, and I was still mad, and he came up to me and put his arm around me. He's like, do you remember me? I'm like, that's a cool guy.
Like,
you,
you
can just laugh
me.
About it. No, he just laughed about it. Obviously, then he wasn't laughing about it as he,
my whole
world head on into the barrier.
Yeah.
But
right. My whole world's over, my career.
Yeah, no, there was no sand trap in that corner. So,
did you know that?
Oh, well, no, you don't assess risk at 20 years old. I just had seen that move in one of the heat races, and I was like, I'm going to do that.
That's my move. Yeah. That's excellent. So then another thing I didn't know about you is the factory deal that you had a long time ago, back in 01, 02?
Yeah, right? Some other manufacturer. The team was PTG. I can't remember who the manufacturer was, but
we'll bleep it out.
No, it's all good. Tom Milner was actually through a mutual contact, Mark Coughlin, who's a guy who's been involved in racing for a long time and, you know, sponsorship agency type stuff. They were looking to replace, I think, Boris and Stuck with BMW NA wanted a young driver group, and so they called a bunch of people for a shootout at Sebring, and I had just had like some email argument with Danica and kind of like went off on her for some stupid thing that we had done in Europe or whatever. And here she was at the test. So it was her and I and Elton Julian. And then you had Bill as the big factory shoe setting the baseline, and the perfect example of being at a runoff on the other side of the fence. And
right.
Tom Milner, just total ball buster,
yeah.
Greatest guy,
still
a great friend. But hardcore. I mean, literally one time I put it in one of the tests, I nosed it into the wall and like scratched the paint. And he literally came up as I was coming back in the safety truck and punched me as hard as he could in
really?
The arm.
Yeah.
And was like, don't ever crash my car again. Like just unreal. So great memories. But
right.
Yeah, he's still, every time he can, he finds me in the paddock and says, you know, you'll never have a better driving opportunity than with me because I paid you and you never even effing raced for me because they pulled out for other
reasons. Was that
your
Tom Milner impression?
It's actually really good.
You are a master of impressionist.
That is really good.
I know. I do try.
We're
in LA.
Seriously,
I
just saw him at Laguna for the finale. I was like, whoa.
Yeah, if only you knew anything about
Well, come
actors.
On. You got to have – it's like half East Coast, half German. It's not really either one. It's something in between.
I was at a test with for a GS team in a Porsche, and he was there with their Panos when they had the Panos deal. And Tommy Jr. goes out and destroys the thing on the outlap at some point. And it was like the whole front end was this total development piece they were trying out, and he literally lost it on cold tires and just ripped the whole front end off. And his dad took his headset off and threw it across the front straightaway and just started screaming obscenities. And I was like, oh, man, Tommy's not going to make it.
That's not going to
be
good.
Like, he's going to kill his kid.
Yeah. So. I remember Tommy was like just started doing some KRC Arrive and Drive go-karting out here in Willow Springs when we were doing that deal. And like, talk about full circle feeling old. But no, there was we never ended up racing, but Tom honored the agreement and everything. But one of the tests at Sebring, when we were sort of still deciding how we were going to race, if we were going to race, Bill totally instigated something with the young drivers. And I won't go into detail. We'll save the time. But
there was some
bodywork damage. No massive crash, but a little bit of rubbing, if we would say, on the rental cars.
Okay.
And it just so happened that the car that took damage was rented by Tom for one of the undisclosed young drivers.
Ah.
And so being Bill Oberlin and just making it hard on the young guys, so he instigated it all, and then he went and told Tattletailed, and another nice interaction with our new boss.
Nice.
So great times.
So speaking of impressions,
I
am told, and I've witnessed to, and we can edit this later, an amazing Bill Oberlin impression.
No.
Come on, do it.
You know what? No one could impersonate that guy.
But anybody could.
No.
If just one guy.
But if one guy at this table.
I have so much respect for his candidness.
No. He said candidness.
Okay.
He didn't say anything else. So
next question.
So I don't think a lot of people know you were up for the Red Bull program way back when.
Yeah. I don't know if that's a huge secret.
Okay.
But that was my gateway to Porsche, actually. You know, it was the first round of the U.S. Formula One driver search.
Back in 2002, Red Bull announced that they were going to find a young American driver, cultivate him. They had this whole little development runoff program thing. And,
correct.
And there was you and a handful of guys were up for it.
Yeah, they basically came out in the media and said, look, we have a U.S. Grand Prix now a couple years going at Indy, and we've got no U.S. driver. And corporate America is not going to step up. We're going to step up, and we're gonna make this a mainstream talent search for a Formula One driver, and we're going to take him to Formula One. And so, of course, a few of us, there was only a couple guys at each year living and racing in Europe. It's much more popular these days. We think, well, finally our gravy train has showed up. And then we see the list. They employed Danny Sullivan to go to every track in America, from short track, dirt tracks, to drag racing, to obviously formula car racing in Europe, and put together a list. And it was a pretty crazy list. Ryan Hunter Ray, AJ Allmendinger, Joey Hand, Scott Speed, myself. I mean, a lot of California karting kids that you had mentioned earlier. It was a strong group. And basically they took us around the Grand Prix at Indy. and announced to the Formula One world that somewhere in here was one of the best drivers or the best driver in road racing that's from the U.S. or has a U.S. passport. So the little bit of maturity I had in me knew in the back of my mind that this was a win no matter what, and that it was going to be a crapshoot because 16-1.
Yeah.
You know, with that lineup of guys,
yeah.
You don't know how it's going to go down. But I was still pretty confident because I was living over there and running those types of cars,
stuff,
and
right.
The test was at Paul Ricard, and I knew that track. And anyways, it didn't go the way I hoped. I went from 16 down to the final six, and they took four out of the six. The interesting part, the kind of backstory of that, was that there was a group of highly clouded judges and all this testing and different cars and BSR Formula 3 cars and Formula 3000, everything you could hope for with Red Bull all over it.
Yeah.
You know, we're all in our brand new Alpine Star suits and it's just awesome. We're staying at Bernie's hotel across the street.
Yeah.
And then this guy Helmut Marko shows up.
Right.
And everybody's like, you know, you cue the Star Wars music, like literally crazy craziness.
Darth Vader.
And yeah. And he just basically pushes all the paperwork off the tables and he's like, okay, put them all in cars. Let's see them. And like five laps, he made his decision on everything.
Right.
It's like everybody else was just, this is my take on it.
Yeah.
Everybody else was kind of put to a second seat on the deal. And he saw certain things in certain people and it was his show and that was it. So, you know, I'm head in my hands, flying back the next morning with a couple other guys that got dropped like a bad habit, thinking, yeah, all right, I literally at that point was barely squeaked by on the Formula Renault season. No way I was going to put a Formula 3 deal together. So it was back to the U.S., start working in the wood shop for my dad, try to put a couple of Atlantic races together. Bobby Ray Hall had said, look, you know, we can do something here and I can try and help you. He was a big part of yeah, helping me out. And Porsche called Danny Sullivan and was like, you know, we saw something in a couple of kids that we'd like to take a look at. If you haven't taken them, can you send them our way? And so the next morning I was in Vysok and I opened the pearly gates and it was like, this is awesome.
Right.
You yeah know, this is not Formula One, but this is unbelievable. And yeah, the rest is history, as they say. I mean, I tested for their UPS junior team, which is their farm league, in-house farm league,
yeah,
raced Carrera Cup and Super Cup, one make Porsche racing in Europe that next year. And then the year after was 2004 and I was signed full time to be an ALMS. I never raced in the US at that level. I had done some Skip Barber regional stuff, but I didn't know the racetracks. I didn't know what ALMS barely was. I was still learning the sports car rules and regulations. And I showed up in 03 at the end for Petit Le Mans and drove with TRG just to kind of get my feet wet. But yeah, really interesting education, a quick immersion into sports car racing in a great era of GT racing against the Alex Jobs and the Reezys. And one step back from that was I had been introduced in 1999 to Le Mans through living in Le Mans, going to this racing university that's called La Filière. And I want you to ask Oriel about La Filière because he also
hold
came
on to
through
that. We got a segment for that.
Got it. Okay. So, you know, Frank Montagny, you know, Garcia, Oriel.
Was Montagny a good could get a party with?
Did he have a good time?
Next question. So a lot of guys came out of there, Collard, and you know, a lot of French guys, Bourdais, they all came through La Filière, and it was this racing university. But long story short, we got a ticket to Le Mans, which is where we went to school every day in the center of the racetrack in the Technopark. We got a ticket to check the race out. It was a weekend off from racing in the French formula car. We were in like the Skip Barber equivalency one make series in France and going to university in between the race weekends. And they said, here's a ticket, one ticket per three guys to Le Mans, and you could just rotate through the 24 hours and check it out. And 99 was a pretty cool year. That was the last year that Mercedes was there when Dumbreck went over and Weber went over. It was Nissan had something in there. Obviously BMW won. Toyota was there for the last year with their monster LMP1, whatever it was called then, GT1. And I just, my eyes were open to the world of sports car racing at the very best event, and pretty overwhelming, awesome event. So 3 years later, when the phone rings and it's Porsche, I'm still kind of on the fence, like, maybe I can make it in Atlantic racing.
Because right. I assume the psychology at this point is, you take a factory deal, your dream of open wheel, of driving the Indy 500, being an F1 driver, is
difficult.
Over.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, they made it really clear to me. They were like, we like what we saw. We want to sign you, but we've seen this too many times. Lucas Lure, Timo Bernard, Mark Lieb. These guys had all come through right out of Formula Car Racing, and I don't know which ones had said, hey, can I do some Formula Car Racing in my off weekends? They were like, if you come with us, it's us.
That's it.
You're not going back home and racing in some other championship.
So this is a choice now.
So that left me sort of like in this question in my mind of do I or don't I? And that just goes to show, I still talk to a lot of young drivers these days who are like, I'm thinking I might be able to do 3 Formula Mazda races next year, or I have this Conti season fully paid for, and I'm like, what?
What
like,
are you thinking? Right.
So, but that was me.
Yeah.
And so I had to go home and think about it.
Yeah.
And this is a story I've told a lot in the media, and forgive me if you've heard it 15 times, but I called like 20 people that would answer my phone call, and they all answered the same thing. Like,
just take it.
What? Like, it's Porsche. They've been in motorsport forever. They're loyal to their drivers. Their stuff wins. You're a young, snot-nosed punk to even be asking this question.
Sure.
And I never looked back since then. I've never wondered or said, what about that or this? And the coolest part is they've let me go try some other types of racing later on in my career with them. So they're not jealous lovers in the sense that, like, if you want to go do a V8 race or you want to try a nationwide race on a road course or a rally car race, they're fine with it. As long as you're not competing against Porsche and you're not, quote, busy when they need you, they're pretty willing. So I've been able to kind of revisit other types of racing that maybe I thought would have been cool to race a late model at Mobile, Alabama. I've been able to go down and do that stuff. So
speaking of NASCAR, we were talking about this on the drive-in. You were so close to winning your big Can-Am road race outbreak.
Oh, man. This is another Formula Ford festival.
Right, exactly. It goes back to the story from earlier.
So you have this history of dumping people.
Yeah. Not anymore. Like,
why are you so aggressive?
I'm now, like, really mellow. But
basically, the big sprint cup race at Sonoma, and I forget what year. It was, like, 08 or something like that.
Yeah.
Can-Am is the lead-in. It's the Saturday race. There's no nationwide. So it's you and some new big nationwide kid named Joey Logano, who's in his rookie year.
Sliced bread.
And
toast.
And it's you and him the whole race, and you're on him. And what happens on the white flag lap?
Well, it was the typical bump and run, and I thought I pulled it off with mastery.
With
like
gusto.
It was perfect. Like, I didn't dump him, I didn't spin him, I moved them.
Yeah.
And that's all I've ever grown up watching. I mean, I went to Bristol in '88 as a 6-year-old kid, as a NASCAR fan, and sat in the stands with binoculars and watched Dale Earnhardt. So I've seen that crap before I started racing go karts.
Yeah.
And I thought, like, I went across the start-finish line. I'm like, this is amazing.
Nailed it.
You know? And then, you know, it's this typical deal. I mean, I should have learned 8 years earlier at the Formula Ford Festival. This time I didn't run my mouth, but I took out the guy that was paid to show up. And that's literally the words I got in the hauler.
Wow.
Was like,
oh,
no.
They literally said, like, you took him out specifically.
You dumped the guy that we paid to show up. Like, so it's something
that
along
sucks.
Those lines.
Yeah.
And I won't say who or where, but you can figure
enough.
It out.
Yeah.
So – backing up, it was one of those deals where I'm running for a local team of a guy that from your neck of the woods. Where is he from? He's like from Fontana area, Sunrise. He's
I love that
Bob
Pasadena
Roncani.
Is in the same category as Fontana.
Yeah, it's like
by
out
the way.
There where it's like where the wind blows
right.
And you're at the base of the mountains. So
yeah, that's Pasadena.
Yeah, so Pasadena is pretty nice actually. We did an event there a couple years ago.
And it's actually a nice area, and it's in fact not Fontana.
I realize I finally offended you in all the years that I've met you. So
you insult my current hometown.
So we're the local ringer team, road course only guy. And then Joe Gibbs shows up with the Home Depot, whatever it was, Chevy Lumina. Like, you know, they've got
immaculate.
30 times the guys that everybody else has got. Everybody else is in jeans, and they're like the cup team.
Right.
And I put it on pole. He's second, and he comes up to me at introductions, and he's like, where'd you come from? And I'm like, I'll see you later.
Exactly. Right.
You
know?
So I pass him fair and square, and they throw yellow, the typical green-white checkered yellow. But on the road course, they revert back to the last time you went across start-finish. So that was like 3 minutes before I had made the overtaking maneuver to take the lead through strategy. And, lo and behold, I'm third. I'm not going to lead into the green-white checkered. So, yeah, my Irish was up at that point. I figured
– flared a little bit.
I figured I'd rather go for the win than – you know, finish second to who was going to win the race anyways. So,
Now, is in the back of your mind? I mean, I'll give you credit because you just love all kinds of racing. I was at Irwindale with a client and you were there in the stands just as a fan, which blew my mind for just a late model race. But you know, you were on that path for a couple of years. You were doing more and more in stock cars. but you were up for a nationwide deal, as I remember, with Roger Penske for a few races. I don't know if that's public or not.
Yeah.
Okay. Was this the path you were kind of looking at going for a couple of years?
You know, it did kind of start when I was driving in the RS Spider program. You know, walking around Penske in Mooresville, there's a lot of nice stuff. And, you know, the RS Spiders were prepped just around the hall from all the Cup team, all the Nationwide team, the IndyCar team was there. And I was just keen to get in one of those. I had always wondered what it would have been like, especially on a road course with a live axle and that much horsepower. Welcome to LA. Here we go.
And rooftop.
They weren't going to throw me the keys to a Nationwide car. I thought that might be possible, but they're pretty pragmatic, and they were very open with me. I mean, they said, look, you need to go get your feet wet and figure this out before you make a fool of yourself. You can't just jump straight in. And I think a lot of guys would attest that it's not that easy. So, fine. I went and talked to some people who are always kind of in the background, like, hey, if you ever want to do something, we'd love to help you out. Obviously, you don't need funding to go Porsche racing, but if you want to do something, let us know. So fast forward, we go and we went all the way from the bottom, from late models to Cup, and I got into everything. You know, we did all right. We won an ARCA race and a couple of K&N races. The Nationwide deal, you know, top 10 qualifying type stuff, but it's a lot harder than it looks, especially in this day and age. The day of the ringer is gone. I'm sure you guys have covered. So, yeah, the goal.
No, we haven't.
Okay. No, give us too much credit.
Yeah. So
we're not covering news here.
Anyways, the day of the ringer is that you used to be able to be Scott Pruitt or Andy Lally and just jump in and put it on pole. And now the roundy round guys have figured out how to go very fast on a road course, and their stuff is super strong at the front. And I don't care who you are, you can't show up with a start and park team and get into the top 10. It's
absolutely.
Just those days are gone. It used to happen. You know, Tommy Kendall, a lot of them have done it over the years. But anyways, yeah. So there was a two-part goal. One was just to experience it, to take it off the bucket list, to wonder what it was like to hold it wide open in turn one qualifying at Iowa. And the other side of it was it must be a fight at the boardwalk, because that's usually what goes down around here.
That's cool.
So we're going to the boardwalk next.
Yeah, oh, that's next. Stop.
Yeah.
Go on. I'm sorry.
Muscle Beach. So this is a really long answer, but the bottom line is I wanted to experience it, but I also wanted to do some legitimate road course racing, and I knew I had to pay my dues at the bottom level and learn what track bars were and wedge, and not just show up and be like, give me three clicks of high speed when there's no high speed on the damper.
Sure. Yeah. Sure.
And you were up for the 22 car in Nationwide, which is like, that is, if you're going to run a road course, that's a Penske-owned car. A bunch of guys have run through it, and that's a winning car. And as I was told, in 2013, you were up for all the road course races with Penske in the Xfinity Series. So it was the 22 Mid-Ohio, Road America, Watkins Glen.
Yeah, I can't comment. I can't comment on rumors.
Okay.
I can't comment on rumors. Maybe. but the bottom line is that work called. I didn't think I was going to have a Le Mans ride that year. And the story is that, you know, I might have had a ride, and the phone rang, and it was like,
story,
hey,
is.
We have this really interesting idea, and you may go to Le Mans with Patrick Dempsey and try to go challenge the rest of the category. And I thought, let's talk about it. And so that was the beginning of where my full-time ride is today.
Yeah.
So it's an interesting fork in the road that maybe was a little bit of wishy-washy at the time, but now obviously it probably wouldn't have been healthy for my career to say, I'm going to go, you know, play in some stock cars at the same time. You know, where would we all be today? You know?
And is it crazy to look at your career today and say, my teammate is Marco Seyfried?
No. it's awesome. That guy is like the most underrated driver on this planet. And
I don't think he wants that out there, because he's a silver.
He's
very happy as a silver.
Already met with Bo.
You got me in my 30s. I'm telling politically incorrect stories. I don't care about the politics anymore. So
40s are going to be awesome.
I'll be that guy at a wedding who wasn't invited.
Just
so
slurs.
like Sean. So
I'm angry.
Yeah. So Seyfried's great, man. That guy. So I raced against him in Super Cup over 10 years ago, and he's a mechanic and just wanted to race. I mean, sounds familiar, you know.
But yeah, I'm like, I don't know anybody
so,
like that.
So just a guy that just works so hard, and it was one of the deals where I kind of like my diva moments that come out regularly. I just said I have to have this guy on the team. It's the gel that we need between Patrick and I as a guy who's just selfless, doesn't need a lot of time in the car, is just rock solid, reliable. And yeah, it's been a great season. He's, you know, he was out here for Rennsport reunion as a fan. Talk about as a fan.
That's awesome.
And I gave him the keys to one of my vintage cars, and I was like, it's a long drive, but if you've always wanted to do it, why not do it in a 73 911? And man, like, not a more grateful guy that literally sat in that car and sweat his, you know what, off for You're 8 hours and came with a smile, just
sure.
bloodshot eyes, and was like, that was awesome. You know, no AC and just by himself, you know, it's really? Just, he's just a great guy.
That is awesome. I didn't know that about him.
Yeah,
we'd known each other, Marco and I, for like an hour at Sebring back in 2014, and we started doing video segments for Magnus, and the things I got him to say on camera, having not known me nor my sense of humor, I give him a ton of credit, how he just jumps right in.
So. See, that's the thing about you guys. It's always a little nerve-wracking, but there's some form of it's okay if you're with Sean, you know, like,
oh, that's a career ending mistake right there.
I don't know. It eases the pain of all the trouble I'm going to be in for this interview, you know?
Yeah. Cause they love me over there at Porsche.
Everybody loves you.
Lots of fans.
I got 6 followers on Twitter. Yeah, I got nothing.
I told Shane Mahoney yesterday, I said, I'm doing an interview with Heckman. And he's like, oh, no, he was like, that's awesome.
Can we talk about that for a second?
Like, yeah. He's like, that's awesome. Right.
Yeah, Shane and I go way back. But let's see. So off the track here. So here we are at a dais, and you put together your first car show here a couple of years ago. And what I like about that, it's not so much that you're putting on car shows or anything like that. It's that you're a racing driver who finally has to do real administrative work.
Yeah, I mean, not have
well,
to.
Well, no, I was going to say, he doesn't have to, which right. is more impressive to me because he's doing it in your spare time.
I don't mean it like that. I mean, I just meant, like, Porsche didn't ask me to do
well,
it.
Right,
or
no,
that
to me is more impressive than saying, hey, we're paying you salary. You
no,
do,
figure it
do
out.
This.
No,
trust you, me. You wanted to because you love the brand, you love the cars and the history.
Yeah, there's not a dollar in it. I basically, I don't tell short stories, so here we go.
That's right.
I fell in love with the vintage 911 a long time ago, but I didn't know anything about it. I would just...
Right.
You know, test a car or race a car and be like, oh, that was awesome. That was cool. But I don't even know what I just drove. And so I really started getting back into the history of the road car side of the company. I knew in the racing history. But as I started getting more involved in the road car side of it and the market being very strong, I decided to play with a few vintage 911s rather than, you know, pushing numbers on the stock market, and just fell way into the nerd side of collecting
right.
vintage 911s and started going to shows. I grew up going to vintage car shows with my uncle and my grandpa. That's how I got into racing. And as much as I'd been exposed to it, I still couldn't find a way to like convince a non-motorsport friend to go with me because it was just a little too stiff and a little too like you have the wrong hubcap on your car.
Yeah.
And I'd find myself at a barbecue. I'd go with my wife to a barbecue with our friends here in Venice, and then I'd come out and like the neighbors would be like looking at this car and be like, tell me about this. We don't know anything about this. We see him over on Abbott Kinney, and I just thought, let's do an event that brings people from outside the car nerd world to an exposure of an event that people would want to be at regardless of the cars, but people who do want to learn a little bit about Porsche's history, let's line them all up here in the parking lot at a great place on the corner of one of the busiest streets in Venice, West LA, and just let people trickle in with their baby carriages and their random dogs and rub up against, you know, Chad McQueen's car and check out some cool stuff. And we didn't know what to expect. The guys at Deus were like, no problem. Typical Aussies, like, yeah, man, no worries. Like, why we're on their roof right now? They're just like, they don't really ask for you to sign anything or promise anything. And it just exploded. The power of social media and you know, certain people showing up, the Jeff Swartz of the world, it just blew up with no media and no marketing. And then we thought, wow, we're on to something. And so we did one 5 months later at a bigger venue, and now it's kind of become you know, maybe a biannual just shindig of music and tacos and a lot of really cool vintage 911 stuff. So it's called Luftgekühlt, which means in German, air cooled.
One more time, please.
Luft is air. Uh-huh. The Kult, you can kind of, it means cooled in German, but we kind of thought Luftgekühlt, like a cult.
Okay.
So sure. Luftgekühlt, and it means air cooled, which means anything that Porsche produced 911-wise up to 1998 had no radiators and no water cooling. And so that's where we stop. So it's basically from 58 to 98 or 48 to 98, anything that was built, 356s, 906s, and mostly 911s.
And you guys drove Bruce Meyer's K3 1979 overall Le Mans winner on the streets to this event, right?
Yeah, I didn't. But our second event, our bigger event, Bruce heard through the grapevine that there was this get-together in Culver City, which is pretty close to Beverly Hills, where he keeps his immaculate collection.
Unreal place.
Yeah, I saw you there. And so he emailed me out of the blue and was like, hey, I heard you guys are doing an event. I think Danny Sullivan told him, and Sullivan's a Porsche air-cooled head as well. And he goes, I'm going to bring something, something special. And I'm like, what is it? You know, because I just nerd out about all this stuff. Like, right. I want to know what the original color was and how you got the car and if it was in your family or blah, blah, blah. And he's like, don't worry about it. It's something cool. And I'm like, well, okay, I need to get you inside because our like special stuff was inside where the T-shirts and the posters and the food was. And he's like, I'm like, I need you there by 6. You know, this is my event planner side, with the clipboard and the headphones. And he's like, I was thinking 9:30. So like the little bubble in my head is like, all right,
how do I do this?
Let's do the Elvis entrance. Yeah. And so we literally parted the seas of 1,000 people and a smoking, idling 79 Le Mans winning 935, which is a 911 on steroids.
Yeah, priceless.
Smoky, loud, multi-millions of dollars. Yeah. And he just cruises in this car that most of us have dreamt of seeing once, let alone it cruising down Rodeo Drive on a Sunday morning.
That's awesome.
And that's just the type of script that you can't write for these types of shows. And people come out of the woodwork because it's not a concourse. You're not on a golf course. There's no judging. There's no entry fees. It's just Southern California car people, and we want to like take that laid back mentality. We've got plans to go to Japan and Germany next year, and we also want to go to the East Coast. But I always bite off more than I can chew, realizing that, you know, first of all, committing to a date is not always easy, and then it's a lot of time and effort to get, you know, 400 cars parked and in a curated way. It's not just a parking lot and show up on Sunday mornings at 8:30.
Right.
We want to tell a story and for it to kind of be an experience. It's not micromanaged to like one place, but we certainly kind of organize through era and motorsport versus road. And it evolves and changes. The goal is to have a different venue so that the venue like Deus is exposure for the car people, and it's a trip for them. And then all the hipsters who are normally at Venice or the bike guys get to trip out on the Porsche. So it's about cross-pollinating and not locking anybody out.
So you've been all around the world, kind of going with the travel theme. Best place you've raced outside of the country, outside of the States?
Hands down, Surfers Paradise.
I was going to say Australia.
And I had always heard about it, and, you know, you think you've seen it. And really what I saw were skyscrapers and, you know, bikinis and volleyball. But it's just, I don't know, it's just I hate this word, the vibe. It's like everybody's just stoked and it's racing, and I don't know. It's like Long Beach with the Aussie laid back spirit.
Sure.
And that's Australian racing, hands down, is just something different that I love.
When you went down there for the Aussie V8s, is it as big as NASCAR is here? Because that's the way it's portrayed back to the States, that like those drivers walk down the street and they get mobbed by the fans. It's a big deal.
So I got on the plane. They hand you the newspaper on the Virgin Australia, and like the center of the Australian newspaper is the preview for the race I'm heading to. And then you watch the online on demand, and it's V8 racing on the Virgin 747. And then you get off and you go to the newsstand in the airport to get the Autosport or whatever it's called, Auto Action. And there's a stand up of James Courtney, and you know, it's one of the top, I don't know, three sports.
Right.
You really, when you talk about racing down under, it's certainly V8s. And it's interesting. It's like NASCAR in that it's really stayed strong just down there, but I'd say it's as strong as NASCAR to the public in the South. You see it everywhere, and it's cool though. It's got a good flavor. You got a lot of European engineering guys that have gone down there and made a full-time gig. Most of the drivers are local, because first of all they're good, but second, those cars are, I think, the hardest car I've ever had to adapt to, the driving style of them. You need to be in those cars full season.
Right.
And there's been a few guys from abroad that have made full-time swings down there, but it's a long, hard road to get up to speed.
Sure.
I've always thought if I was ever going to do it, I would do the second tier sort of equivalent, Xfinity nationwide equivalent, which is all the Dunlop series.
Right.
Because they're big, big, heavy cars with a lot of horsepower and very small tires and very hard brake pads, spec brake pads, and so you know, it's putting a train on edge and holding it there in the streets of Surfers. It's not easy.
So we have a couple of things we've been doing from episode to episode, and earlier you kind of alluded to this for our next guest. So we met with the Speed Freaks yesterday.
Mm.
You familiar with them? Mm-hmm. You've been on their show, apparently.
Yeah, they're a great group, and they've also taken me outside of that robotic state, maybe one of a few others.
So we obviously gave both Kenny and Crash a question for you, and great. You're going to answer the question, and then you'll ask a question for our next guest, which will be Oriel Servia. So Crash's question for you was, how many Porsches do you own?
That's not a question I've ever answered.
Have you ever been on a podcast before?
How many Porsches do I own? Roughly a handful.
That's roughly a handful.
More than I'd like to admit.
Okay.
Okay, so give us a window.
The bug has bitten me.
Above okay, six, under
yes.
10.
Yeah.
Okay.
Above enough. Six, under 10.
Somewhere in there. All right, good enough. Yeah. That's a handful.
All right.
So
the next one is from Kenny.
Oh, God.
Who's extreme.
Is it about, like, spandex?
Yeah, it's in that realm.
Ginger.
No, that's my territory.
Oh, sorry.
And that joke's played out, so yeah. I'm not going there anymore. Wait, are the homeless? Oh, boy. All right.
Well, it's getting warm.
The neighbors are just waking up.
12:20.
Lunchtime.
It's good times. If you could sit in anyone's seat, but not just their seat.
Hang on.
Okay.
It was specifically IndyCar or sports car for
some
reason.
Is that what he said?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't remember that part.
Okay, got it.
If you could not only sit in their seat, but their, you know, because it's extreme, their piss-filled seat.
Okay.
Kaboom.
Rock on.
Rock on.
All right.
Who would it be?
That's not too bad. Like,
all right.
I was.
Keep in mind, you can get herpes from piss.
I know, but Kenny's throwing me some big curveballs, like, live on air.
Really?
I think I got off easy on this one.
Okay.
If I could sit in anyone's seat.
Piss,
now, I guess we're not talking about
filled.
Their car or the prep of the team.
But that was not. That was not
I kind of want to know who I want to, like, whose piss I want to sit in.
Yeah, whose piss do you want to sit in is basically it.
Yeah.
Man, I could answer this question, whose piss have I sat in? And that would be a long
list.
That's a
great
question. Okay, well, that'll be a follow-up.
So let's, yeah.
That's my question for Serbia.
It just turns into 12 people asking about this seat.
Yeah, basically that question has just turned into, yeah. You're
gonna pass along.
Oh, now she's changing.
Oh, is she?
Okay.
Oh wow, she's literally
a show.
Get
wow.
the camera on, Sean.
No, no, this is bad. This is a memory I don't want.
Thanks for bringing me here. I don't know how to answer that.
I don't know how to answer that question. As
that's weird.
Are you turning
that.
Towards Sean so you just don't catch
so
a glimpse of that?
Yeah. I mean, yes, yeah. I'm trying to not be in trouble here.
There's a live homeless show next door.
Yeah. I don't think they're homeless. I just think it was a big night.
Oh, you think so?
They've got, like, good beach cruisers.
Okay, yeah.
They're like, kind new. Of
big They've got good beach cruisers. They're doing okay. They're doing okay.
That's just a loud Wednesday night in Venice right there. I'm going to just pick a random name.
okay.
No, Ryan no. Eversley.
That's not true.
That's bullshit.
I don't know. What? How would you sum up someone's
okay,
key that you want to sit in? What would that describe them as to you?
We've had a lot of driving time. To just, like, think about stuff. And so I was like, okay, I guess for me, when I'm, like, full tilt training mode and I'm hydrated, it's just basically coming back out water. It's as clear as can be. So,
yeah.
So I thought, okay, who is, like, the most in-shape person I know? Because then I would just be sitting in water. You know, that's kind of the direction I went. And then I also thought, wow, if I went the other way, like, who's the worst? You know, like, Tony Stewart. I wouldn't want to sit in his seat because that's going to be just, like, raw urine. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you fortunately get to pick who's clean piss you want to sit in.
Well, you can pick anybody, really. Maybe we don't know what you're into.
Yeah, it could be like a female driver.
Awesome.
Could be.
Like I already. Craig Stanton is the fittest human being.
Ooh. Excellent.
That is a good answer.
What does he say? 41 years old. We all know Craig
is 38.
He's definitely past the 50.
Like 62.
And that guy's like always just smiling and just ran up a mountain and it was 117 degrees. So I'm gonna go with your connection to the cleanest pee and take that as my final answer.
That is a good answer.
So looking ahead in your career, we'll use Craig as an example. So Craig is in his 50s and still happy as can be. Every time I see him, he's out
ripped.
Coaching. He's not only is he ripped, but he's pleasant as hell. And I would imagine at that age, coaching newbies all the time, having to say the same good job kind of speech is really, really difficult. And he wouldn't know to talk to him. And he may be fine with it. Looking at your career, is that a path you see yourself going down in the future, or are you setting yourself up for for life away from a racetrack entirely once you're once this all comes to an end?
Well, first of all, Craig's way more positive than anybody at this table.
Absolutely.
And he's way happier. And he's, like, just happy every morning. I'm like, what do you eat? I want that because
right,
I can be a little – yeah. So the other thing about Craig is he loves the racetrack, like,
sure,
more than life itself.
Sure.
And I can't say I honestly, like, live to go rental kart racing on a weekly basis. But
sure,
I think Craig does. Like,
yeah,
I see Craig running in the crappiest go-kart at the crappiest track in the crappiest weather. And he's like, this is awesome. I love driving. I don't know if I can be doing that. I hope at 50 I'm that pumped. I'm still that pumped today, but Craig got a lot of energy, man.
That dude duped me into doing the 25 Hours of Thunder Hill with the exact same attitude. He's
yeah,
like, I'm driving this car, and the team is awesome. It's
yeah,
going to be great.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah. And I'd never been there before, and it's like, you know, 40 degrees and raining. And
in the middle of
in
nowhere.
In the middle of nowhere.
In December when the rest of your friends are like in the Bahamas.
Exactly. And I'm thinking, Craig, I hate you right now,
yeah,
man. And, and of course, the whole time he's like, right, isn't this great?
Yeah, love that.
Even
brushing
when he's
his teeth in the trash can.
Exactly. Even when he's in a bad mood, he's like, I know, I get it. He's
yeah,
smiling. You're
yeah,
like,
yeah. One yeah, time I was, well, 10 years ago, I was at Big Willow coaching, and he's like, can I go in the right seat with you? And I'm like, you're winning ALMS races. I'm like, just punk, and yeah, let's go. So I kill the engine on the back straightaway because I can hear him screaming and I want to hear what he's saying.
Sure.
So I literally in the back straight, there's no one on the track. I just shut the ignition off and he was saying nothing. He was just like hooting and hollering and just like double shakas like with a 3-point harness. And I was like, God love the guy.
That is awesome.
Well, one of the things that made Craig last for as long as he has and continues to do is that he's such a good guy that he's the kind of guy that a newbie who wants to maybe try pro racing and have a co-driver, he can latch onto that guy and get himself that ride. Ryan is in this position a lot. You're luckily for the last year or two, you're not in that position. But guys like Ryan, Craig, Andy, they all have to adapt themselves to somebody who, you know, who can fund their racing efforts. You've been lucky enough the last few years. You don't have to do that with the factory deal. Are you? I'm sure you're thankful, but do you see that changing? Is this something you're trying to avoid?
I don't overanalyze it because, to be honest, for 8-9 years, that's all I did. I mean, when we started GT racing, when I started with Porsche, they were GT racing in Pro-Am setups, so it was already sort of that way. And I still, on the off weekend, will go to Bathurst and run with a friend. So either way, if the equipment's safe and fast and it's a good guy who's progressing, no matter what his level is, and he's good to go out to dinner with, it's sorry to be so cliche, it's more about like living life than it is like
absolutely,
if we're going to get on the podium.
Yeah.
I think about it in sort of a time currency. Like this weekend I could be with family and friends at the beach or I could be in Australia, but I'm having a great time and we're racing a track we haven't raced. So I don't see it any differently. I will admit that at the beginning of this year when I was told by the factory I'd be full-time in GTE AM, coming out of a white factory car and Tudor into GTE AM full-time, I kind of had a little smirk like, okay. And to be completely honest, I've had as much fun this year and we found some success, but we've had fun, that it kind of wrote a new rule for me that it doesn't always matter about the caliper of the program, it's more about the scenario.
Yeah.
Because you know I've been in some high stress, high level programs, and some of them from the outside would be the dream ride, but
yeah,
inside I was just aging by the hour.
Yeah.
Stressed out, strung out, driving for my career, trying to keep it in the window of being on pace and not stacking it into the wall.
Yeah.
And those years make you a better driver, but they are also the years that you're really relieved at the final checkered flag of the
yeah,
season.
Right.
So it ebbs and flows. Every year is a new adventure. That's easily the best part of my job, is that not only is every season a little different, but every day or weekend is a little different. And that to me is why I think we all do this, is that it's a different set of scenarios and scenery every week. And it's kind of a traveling circus where you know the people, but you're in different environments each week. So
when you just to go back to what you were talking about a second ago with being told by the factory you'd be in GTM, as a longtime member of that family for the Porsche factory team, do you feel like they, and this is your perception, not what it actually was, I don't care about that, did you take it as, okay, I'm being moved from the biggest thing to something that's a big deal for them because of the client being Patrick, you know, who they're using for marketing, whatever? Or did you take it as, okay, we're going to put somebody new in a Tudor and Patrick's been there, done that. We'll put him into the AM class. Because if I'm you, I take it as the way I would psych myself into it is like, I'm so good that they're putting me with their biggest face on the planet for marketing their company right now, except for a tennis player, you know. That's why I'm getting that ride.
I'm glad you saw it that way, because I didn't see it that way, and I didn't assume anybody else saw it that way. But through this year, there has been many people have come up to me and said, like, this is cool. This is big. And in the beginning, it's just the competition and the ego, and you're like, wait, I'm going to have a skinny white suit, and now I'm going to not be in that anymore.
So the initial fear, that perception is you've been downgraded, so to speak.
Yeah, or put onto a special project, but
yeah,
the project.
Not the cool one, right, sure.
But I kind of had to practice what I preached all along, which is if you're a factory guy, at least in my experience, you go where you're told with a smile,
yeah.
Because it doesn't get any better.
Yeah.
And you know, they tell you to race a offshore boat or a pink big wheel, do it willingly and never like try and lobby for your own interests. That kind of goes for all of sports car racing. And
yeah,
it's a transition that I try to cut that learning curve with young guys that I'm working with, but also remind myself that if you can put yourself aside, you're going to have a long career. And it's not always easy for me. I mean, I've got an ego, and we all do. And this year has been, I mean, first of all, the championship and the class itself I way underestimated. And then we've found a lot of performance and some good success in the second half of the year. And all of that was a lesson in don't always assume you know it all and know how it's all going to pan out. And it's been a good lesson.
So you've been in the how long you've been a factory guy for Porsche now?
13 years.
So 13 years, and a lot of those guys have been there, like the same driver lineups, or at least, you know,
yeah, about half
stable. Right now, you get, you know, Bruce Meyer calls. He's like, I want to run a factory Porsche next year. I'm going to pay for the whole thing, and you're my guy. Who do you get? Who's your go-to factory teammate? You and York had a good relationship. Is he your initial?
Certainly. It depends where and what it is in the car. You know, Jurg is a guy that he'll tell you himself, he's very intense. He leans on everything from the truck driver to the tires and everything in between. He pushes the envelope, and that's what I needed in my formative years.
Sure.
Because he was hard on me, but he was hard on everybody else, and I could just be the smile, young, innocent, like, B guy. Now Jurg and I we're both kind of pushing the envelope, so sometimes we wind each other up, but in good faith, like, we're close friends, talk on a daily basis. But a guy that, like, I dig racing with is Richard Leitz, who you've worked with, and that guy is classic Austrian.
Yes, he is.
Dry humor.
Yes, he is.
Easygoing, zero ego, hauls ass. I mean, when you write
a variety of interests.
Yes, when you write your typical teammate up, especially if you're as big a pain in the ass as I am, you look for that guy, that Marco Seyfried, Richard Leitz, you know, who lets you be the show pony and just gets in and, like, it's like, oh, you need me to do a quadruple stint in the rain at night? Oh, I love it, you know. It's like the Craig Stanton,
right,
you know, mentality. So, yeah, Richard's another great guy. But, you know, the factory team crop of drivers is an interesting thing. From the outside, we're all brothers and best friends and everything. But, you know, you put a bunch of racing drivers in the same space and – not everyone's going to be the fastest. Not everyone's going to be the touted star. And so, you know, there's certainly inner team competition. But I think that what I've learned is that there's almost, I told someone this story yesterday, there's almost this self-policing spirit. Now, there's the engineers, there's the boss of the program, but it probably goes for GM or Honda or anybody else. If you don't fit in with the other crop of soldiers, they'll pretty much find a way to either make you want to leave or you'll be left.
Yeah.
You'll be invited to leave. So there is there is certainly a code of conduct in these greater crops, because one time you're against each other on a weekend, the next time you're sharing a car, the next time you're on opposite ends of the world, and then you end up rooming together at a fitness camp. So
right. You
have to merge pretty quickly, and there's a lot of cultures in our team, different, probably as diverse as any manufacturer, as large certainly as any culture. We're up over 15 drivers, but Austrians, Kiwis, Americans, French, German. I mean, people coming from many different backgrounds, and that's, at times, can be funny to watch.
My favorite thing about, well, anything, honestly, is personalities. Like, I love reading, you know, about people's, like, documentaries and their biographies and stuff, because I want to know about them. So when I look at like a group, in this case, the fitness camp is what I was going to be my next question that you just brought up. When you guys go do the fitness camp, is how long is it? 2 weeks or something? Or?
Yeah, it's changed, but yeah, roughly 2 weeks.
Okay, and there's 15 to 20 of you there, the whole P1 guys and everything. Is that – no, they're not there?
No, it's GT specific.
Okay. Do they do their own then separate?
Yeah, they do their own like mini camp. I mean, they're like – they go on private jets and stuff. We're riding the back of Condor. We fly Condor Air, but no.
copy.
But yeah, it's a big group.
Yeah, so you guys are all there. And does it like click up? You know, do you have like the Hensler's always off with Sellers because they're Falcon guys, or like Pele and Tandy end up, you know, pranking the other two? Is it at all like that, or is it just business and everybody's there? Like, you know, because I see 15 race car drivers together, and the first thing I think is trouble.
Yeah.
You know, like everyone's going to be messing with everybody. It's going to be a good time. And that's supposed to be like a team building exercise, as I understand it from outside looking in.
You'd be surprised. It's over the years, like back to that kind of self-policing structure, we can move pretty well as a single unit, because if you can't, you kind of get chopped out. But yeah, there's certainly like tighter bonds with full-time teammates, or there might be this breakaway of, you know, four French guys,
sure,
whatever.
Sure.
You know, someone who will do things like Sean does, you know, those types of people will break off. But
sure.
No, for the most part, we all go to dinner at the end of the weekend. The juniors usually get sent to the fitness camp with us, which is not easy for them. I didn't really have the big initiation or the hazing, but
right. There's
definitely some of that these days that we don't put up on social media, but they get a little bit of razzing.
Yeah,
they get their hotel rooms definitely get you know, effed up. So
good. Yeah. As it should.
Yeah. Cool. So so to finish up with the question part of this, you admitted that you would like to sit in Craig Stanton's piss.
Okay.
If I read that
to
correctly.
Recap the highlights.
To recap. So next we're gonna interview Oriel Servia. Are you good with him? Are you friends with him? Know him at all?
Know Oriel pretty well.
Okay.
Respect the hell out of him.
All right,
yeah.
Great. So any question you want to ask him, anything. It could be whose piss would you like to sit in, or what would you change if you had a racing genie?
That was Jeff Brown.
Two different spectrums.
How
there.
Is it to live in L.A., being from Spain, and everybody's like, so where in Mexico are you from?
Boom!
No.
That's
who did that?
Literally, I just came up with that. What I was going to ask, what I want you to ask him is like, he came through the La Filière Elf program quite a few years before I did, and it certainly evolved and changed.
Like the same
but
age.
I want him to tell his stories about that program, because I didn't touch on it very much, and I think it was a pretty big part of his career, because I remember when he came to Indy Lights, he still had it on his collar, which was something we all signed and promised to do, and none of us did. But that's the kind of guy Oriel is.
Sure.
Another point, which you can cut this out, but Oriel has always worn Stan 21 suits and helmets, and like,
I feel
literally
a plug coming.
That guy is like the most loyal. I'm nerding out now, but like, he might be one of the most loyal racing drivers on the planet to wear the same racing suit through umpteen amounts of programs, and I'm sure it's not been 100 for 100, but I think that's kind of the way I would sum Oriel Servia up, is that I don't know any other racing driver who's worn the same brand of racing suit for 20 years.
Yep.
And I just think that that's why that guy has had such a great career, is just, he's just a little bit special in his loyalty or personality or what. I mean, he's massively talented, but he's obviously a cool guy, and I run into him, like, literally in Venice I ran into him at a restaurant, and you know, who am I, you know, and he just rolls up and like, hey man, good to see you, and I just think he's a great guy.
Did you know Spencer Pompelli killed a guy?
So I would like to point out one editorial comment, actually, which is you lived in England.
I'm so confused.
No, it's best that you don't know.
We'll tell you.
Don't worry, we'll tell you later. I would just say there's no way for you to respond to this, but I just want to make an editorial comment based on some conversations Ryan and I have had. You spent years in England.
I know where this is going.
No, you don't know where it's going.
I do.
You think you know
I'll be honest if I'm right. Go ahead.
Okay, because I know you. I think I know where you think I'm going, and it's not.
Right. Go ahead.
You spent years in England.
Now I have two ideas.
You now worked for a German-based company, and you've worked there for years. You have an international roster of teammates and people that you work for.
And I'm married to a Canadian.
I didn't know that part.
That's probably where this is going.
No, what I'm saying is I talk to you, and you still, for the most part, sound like a Californian. And we meet so many friends of ours who've probably never really left the continental U.S., and they still use a lot of bullshit English expressions. They say controversy and, and something is slippy and shit like that, and it drives me nuts. That's it. There's no question.
Oh, good.
It's just a comment.
I honestly thought you were going to be like, why do you sound like a kid who came from international business school in Monaco? Because I
well,
do
we were
sometimes.
Talking, we were making jokes about your Oxford education.
No, no. It's
was
not
it Cambridge
that,
or Oxford?
It's that
Cambridge.
I didn't mean it like that. I meant that my accent sort of sounds like a Swiss kid who spent some summers in California.
No,
people
actually,
like on the
no.
airplane are like, are you Canadian?
I just think you sound like that. Thank God. I appreciate that because I get razzed for that.
No, you really just sound like you're trying too hard. That's
right.
All.
Exactly. I just
you have that like maybe it's because you're teammate, but you have that like actors thing.
Yeah.
Where you like, no, it's not a compliment. Yeah. where you like try and talk like calm and slow, like you're saying something articulate, but really it's just nonsense.
Damn. There I was walking away thinking I really can let my guard down for this guy. And then you go to that.
Okay, so real quick.
You do win.
Can you impersonate any of your teammates? Like, give me a Hensler.
Zakai is snaky and breaking.
That's actually good. Yeah, no, that's actually good.
We're like, what? Okay. He's trying to tell us that the thing's, like, pitch sensitive. Right. The only way he can describe it is, Zakai is snaky.
Okay, so that's fantastic to know. Jorg.
Hi, good morning. I'm Jorg.
That's not bad.
Very nice.
Okay.
Very nice.
Leith is probably too much like Hensler, but it'd be like, so you've been to, you like Asian girls? Yes, Richard, where are you going with? Who would you like to be stuck in an airport with among your Porsche brethren?
Stuck in an airport? I'd never want to be stuck in an airport. I got nothing for you.
That's cool.
I spend way too much time with all those guys.
You're like, none of them.
None of them.
Yeah.
They don't. Honestly, it would be worse for them than me.
That's a political answer.
Yep.
No, it would be. I talk a lot compared to those guys.
Like guys, look at the new thing.
We went from Tokyo to Fuji. It was an hour and a half. And at the end, Makovicky got out and he was like, were you okay? At 1 minute, you stopped talking and we were like worried about you. Like, but like he was being really like candid and serious. And I was actually, this sounds made up, but I was actually feeling like crap from the sushi we pounded the night before that had its skin still on it. And I was like,
yeah.
Right.
Anyways.
All right.
Cool.
You gotta get going.
Yeah.
Well, thanks.
All right. Yeah. That's it.
Continental's got the check.
Don't screw me. Meow, meow, meow,
meow, meow. I'm finished.
Patrick Long on a roof. Deus Ex Machina. What more could you ask in a free podcast? So, big thanks to Patrick Long. Always entertaining. Really awesome just to see sort of where he's at in life and in his career. And this is a guy who you can see is really just content with where he's at and just looking for the next thing and, you know, more power to him. So, to sort of kick off our LA round and wrap this episode out, I figured I'd play for you a little group called The Grouch and Elig. That is E-L-I-G-H, also available on iTunes. Here's a song off of an album from the same name called All These Lights. Enjoy.
Get busy, yeah, who's with me? All these lights and they all so pretty. Just one night to live like kids. See, I'm on fire and it's my city. Let's get busy, come on, who's with me? All these lights and they all so pretty. Just one night to live like kids. See, I'm on fire and it's my city. Big city of dreams, I'm cruising. We playing the game and not losing. Been banging the name and ain't changing a thing. Except won't accept all the rules in it. I'm a fool, made bull, no mule in it. Hella cool, sharp tools on full limits. Dope record, go call Guinness. This moment left's on it, yeah, we all in it. One foot in the government, one foot in the soul. Mix up all the rubbish then, turn that grip to gold. One foot in the government, one foot in the soul. Mix up all the rubbish then, turn that grip to gold. Fire grip to gold. Turn that one to gold. One, one. Let's
get busy. Yeah, who's with me? All these lights and they oh so pretty. Just one night to live like kids. See, I'm on fire and it's my city. Let's get busy. Come on, who's with me? All these lights and they oh so pretty. Just one night to live like kids. See, I'm on fire and it's my city.
You see, the night is on my mind. Making music is on the table. I'm able to do the limbo. Get low and get on the Maybelline. Makeup girl leads a dancing. Not on the pickup, not looking for no romancing. The kids in the hall, we ballin'. We call them the spirits of the fallen angels. Hands to the sky, let them know that we know that they daring. Sharing the rhythm given by God to the people, equal or not. While I have my kids that get caught in the darkness.
One foot in the government, one foot in the soul. Mix up all the rubbish, then turn that grit to gold. One foot in the government, one foot in the soul. Mix up all the rubbish, then turn that grit to gold. Fire, grit to gold.
Three, two, one, one, one.